I present a favorite of towns near and far.
Janner memorized the whole book.
Everyone, good Friday to you.
Good to see everybody.
Chris Wall, executive producer of the animated series, and this is
Andrew Peterson.
Like, we've never done this before. Like, it's like
I know. I keep forgetting. There's always like a weird lag when you're doing Zoom.
Yeah.
But that's okay.
It's okay.
Good to be here.
It has been a wild and crazy day here in Tennessee. Great windstorms and power is all over the place. So Andrew, you are not with power right now. So you're just working the battery and hotspotting.
Yes, I'm watching the battery on my computer closely because it's it's fading, as is the sun. The sun is going down right now. And so we're gonna see how this goes.
Yeah. So we're gonna do our very best here. We're kind of making it work. Thank you for joining us. We have got a really fun evening together here. We've got a really cool interview with Henry Ian that we actually recorded earlier this week. He is working on a show right now, and so we caught him between those filming dates, and you're going to really enjoy that. We have a sneak peek we're going to show you for episode 6, and then we're going to talk a lot of cool behind-the-scenes stuff from episode 5 last week. And then a couple other sneak things we want to tell you about near the end. So we have made great progress on our crowdfunding. If you've been following us out there, we have a round open to help us raise for season two. You can go to invest.angel.com and learn more there. We'll tell you more about that in a little bit. And yeah, Andrew, so many things. We just finished mixing episode 6 and y'all.
It's so good. I've come to the conclusion that I think mix day is my favorite part of the process.
It is pretty cool. Well, in this mix day, which we'll show you a picture here. So this is a picture of us in the studio. And we had some guests this time. Who else was with us here, AP?
We had Mr. Kurt Heinecke, who's the musical genius, music director, I guess is his title, right? He's amazing, amazing, talented dude. And he partnered with Isaac Horn, who is one of the members of the Arcadian Wild, one of my favorite bands in the world. So Isaac was with us. We had Bo with us. And we had Garrett was with us and Rebecca. Yep. It was a party in there. It was good.
Party. It was fun having a full room like that. Normally it's kind of trimmed down to just a few of us. And it was Isaac's first time to get to be with us for the mix. And it was funny because normally when you do your mix round, you know, you write your notes down and then you come back and like talk about those. And the first run through, Isaac didn't have any notes because he was just like enjoying it.
Yeah. It's so fun. And it's funny too, when the music guys are there because they are listening to the music. And like, I'm paying so much attention to dialogue and the way lines are delivered. And I think you're kind of like, you're the meta guy. And those guys are like, every note that they made is like, I think we need the, you know, the timpani's up louder in that 1 second session, you know, section. It's pretty
There was
fun.
A whole thing where Kurt was like, wow, those horns. Yeah, I've got a better version of the horns. Hang on, I got to balance this out. The whole thing. And you and I are back there just snacking.
Yeah, just like, oh, there's horns. Great.
Yeah, exactly. Anyways, good times. Can't wait for you guys to see episode 6 coming up on March 10th. Andrew, some people have noticed that the start time for our season finale, episode 6, is earlier. Why is that?
Oh, is it? See, I don't know these details. Wait, what time is the start time?
Why would we start earlier?
Well, I'm pretty sure I know why, and it's because we're having a watch party, right?
Watch party!
Is that what you're feeding
100%.
Me?
Yeah. So this was your genius idea. Hey, could we binge season 1? And I was like, yeah, we should totally do that.
It's going to be fun. Yeah, we're going to watch all of the episodes with the climax of episode 6 all together. And it's going to be really fun. I haven't watched all the episodes in order yet. You know, like it's going to be such a different experience seeing it all go down.
So we'll have a bunch of our local crew and our team all together next week for this live stream. You do not want to miss it. It does start a little earlier, and then episode 6 will be around its usual time at 7 p.m. Central. But you'll note that it starts at 4:30 Central because we're going to have a good time together. So a lot of fun heading to the finale. And then there's a really fun bit about the finale that I'll tell you later. Stay to the end because there's a really cool special guest we're going to talk about. And we're going to answer your questions. So right now, we want to introduce you to Henry Ian Cusick. So this was such a cool connection to get to have him on our show playing Pete the Sockman. Last couple episodes, whatever you thought you knew about Pete the Sockman has probably changed. If you've read the series, you all know, but Andrew, some huge reveals on who he is, what he's capable of. You know, we visited his treehouse and then he showed up in this epic battle. I would say
one of the big reveals is that Henry Ian Cusick is just a great dude. Like in this interview, I was just like, man, I love this guy. I want to hang out with him. He's amazing.
So let's check out a clip of Pete in action, and then we'll introduce you to Henry Ian Cusick. All right. Hey, Ian, welcome.
Hi, guys. Nice to see you again. Thank you
so
much.
So good to have you.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, congratulations and all on the show. I think it's terrific. I'm really enjoying
watching it. Thank you. You have brought Pete to life in ways that we couldn't even imagine. You know, so many of the voices of these characters have come from Andrew as he's done them as like read alouds, and hearing them fully to life with amazing actors like you has been delightful.
Okay, well, I'll just hand it over to you because you guys guided me through all the the recordings and was so particular on how you wanted things. And I did so many takes that I said to all my friends, have you ever done any voiceover for animation? Because that is a workout, man. That's like being in the theater where you're getting such precise direction on each nuance of a line and trying it so many different ways. I don't know if you guys remember, but I was sweating at the end of it. That was an hour of just like, I remember thinking, this is tough. This is hard work. But stuff that I love doing because I grew up in the theater. That was it reminded me of being back in theater. So thank you for the opportunity. I let you go.
Yeah, I was just going to say, this is your first time trying the voiceover thing or the voicing over for animation.
Yep, first time. Yeah, and
crazy. Does it feel weird now watching this animated character? What's do you still hear your voice or do you accept it as a character? Like what's the, as you've watched the episodes?
I watch it because I don't know what you're going to use. I just give you what I give you. And then watching what you do with it and the movements and the response from all the kids to him and the other people, you know, I forgot. And I was like, you know, so charmed by Pete. I thought there's so much story that you want to know. He's hiding something. And, you know, when she says, oh, every time I see him, she makes me look, I feel sad or, you know, and I think there is a great sadness there. There's so much story. But when I watch it, I remember going, oh yeah, I remember that line. I remember, oh, that's right. Oh, they made that work. Oh, that. And how you do it through doors or walking away or, you know, doing the cartwheels over the things and stuff and the repeats. And it just, yeah, I was really, really proud of it. So thank you.
That's awesome.
Well, it's spot on. And just for the people at home who didn't maybe pick up on this earlier, like one of my favorite thing about you being a part of this series is that your character in Lost was that, like, that was out while I was writing these books, you know, and I had in my mind, whenever I needed to picture what Pete the Sock Man was like, I would be like, oh yeah, it's like Henry Ian Cusick in Lost. That's the thing in my mind. And so the fact that 10, 15 years later, you are actually playing the character is such a mind bending and joyful thing. I'm so blown away.
That's so funny. Yeah. Cause when my, when I saw the picture of the character, I thought, that's me.
Yeah.
That was me in Lost, but a little bit older with the gray. Obviously I don't have the gray anymore because I get younger as I get older.
That's right. That's what's happening here. Yeah, Ian, you've had a bit of a history of playing this kind of just a dynamic characters, which is fantastic. Where in this case, we have a character who has maybe some mental instability, you know, definitely some trauma happening and yet is so affectionate and lovable. You know, the fans have really responded to Pete as this character. Is there in your history of acting, I know you talked about you've been in theater, where does that come from for you? The kind of, I mean, just tender emotional as well as the kind of scattered and manic?
Gosh, you know, I wish I could say I'm an actor that picks and chooses my roles. My roles choose me, I feel. There was a time, you know, when all the roles I were getting were like going from Jesus, but then I played Darwin, and then I played, I played a bishop in Just Let Go. A lot of characters who were, and they're considered, someone said to me, they're gentle, but they're strong, you know. So that was usually with the stuff I was getting. They were gentle men, but there's a steeliness about them. And so that was really my thing. Now, as I get older, I'm just playing out and out bad guys. You know, it's just, it's like, but when I was doing all the good stuff, I was thinking, oh, the universe is telling me something. And I don't know if the universe is telling me something now because I just get to play all the baddies.
I've heard that it's really fun to play the baddies.
It can be, you know, it depends how seriously you want to take it. Because sometimes there was a time when I would take my acting so seriously that I could make myself slightly ill. You know, when I was playing Desmond, for example, there were times I'm going, oh my gosh, I really don't feel well because I'm putting my body through the stress of my character. So, and then it made me realize that I don't want to do that. So if I'm playing this out and out racist bad guy, I have to detach because otherwise it's not healthy for me, you know?
Yeah, that makes a ton of sense.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, in episode four, the 2 weeks ago, we got to see where Pete lives for the first time, Pete's Treehouse. It was a huge delight for fans to get to see kind of like childhood dreams of these huge tree houses. Did you have tree houses at home in Hawaii? Have you lived in tree houses at all?
You know, the first house we lived in Hawaii, we moved in and we had a great tree house and a big, enormous tree. We moved out of that house, but my kids loved it. It was one of those tree houses that, you know, I could fit in, you know, I would be able to climb up in it. And my kids loved it. I never had a tree house growing up. We had like forts down in, by the beach where we would build stuff, you know, because we were into scouts and we try our knots and we erect things. And so we had forts and stuff, but no tree houses.
Yeah.
Would I live in a tree house? Yeah. I've seen those cool ones. You see them on Instagram with that, you know, the round, the bubble thing.
Oh yeah.
Have you seen those? But I'm also scared of heights, so maybe not.
And you, we talked about this early on, your accent is hard to track. Tell us about where you grew up and kind of, you know, where you're from.
Yeah, so I'm Peruvian. My mother's Peruvian, my father's Scottish. And at a very early age, we went to live in Madrid in Spain. And then we moved to Trinidad and Tobago, where I spent from 4 to 14. So that was, you know, my most formative years. And that was when I had that real Trini accent, you know, come now. And then I moved to Scotland at 14, which is very difficult because the accent is very difficult. They had no idea what I was saying. I had no idea what they were saying, even sometimes now when I'm in certain cities in Aberdeen, in Scotland, like Aberdeen, I'm like, what? And then we moved to, I moved to England, spent a few years there, and now I live in Hawaii. Wow. So, yeah, my accent's kind of.
Tell us about your, sorry, I know Zoom makes it hard to know when to interject. What was your training like? You mentioned theater. Did you start in theater with hopes of like, oh, I'd love to be in television and film one day? Like, what's the story there?
So I was in my final year at school at 16, and I knew I did not want to go to university or college. I didn't want to open another book. And somebody came around saying, auditions for the National Youth Theatre. And I said, what's that? And I went and I auditioned because there were only two people from Scotland that auditioned there. Everyone else, you know, went to the Scottish Youth Theatre. So the National Youth Theatre was not well represented. And I guess they wanted some people from Scotland. There was me and a girl with a hula hoop. And I did Ina Barbas. I couldn't remember my lines, but I got in. But that was a life-changing moment at 16. I thought, this is what I want to do. I don't care if there's no money, but this is my group of people that I want to hang out with. And ever since then, I was doing amateur dramatics and just doing any kind of theater. Like, I would just love being in the theater with lighting, stage management, just loved being in that environment. Then went to drama school and followed the theater part because I really just wanted to be in that environment. And then had kids, thought there's no money in this, and moved into TV. And so I haven't done theater since. But my heart, I think most British actors are all theater actors, but I do feel way more comfortable. We're just talking about stage fright, you know. I'm not sure if I can go on stage again, to be honest. I could, but you know, I'm not sure I would enjoy it. But on set, for example, film sets, TV sets, I feel at home. I feel more comfortable there than anywhere else, to be honest.
And do you think it's because you, like, when you're on set, you have a few goes at a take. You can kind of fine tune it as opposed to like the high energy, like I've got to get this right now.
Yeah, perhaps. I know with theater, it's like you miss that beat. You know, if you go, oh, I missed that. You know, I'm still thinking about the beat I missed. I think television, like a bit like maybe doing a voiceover, you're just focusing on that little section. That's all you're focusing on. So you can really give your attention to that and then that bit and then that bit, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Whereas with theater, it's the whole thing. And it's hard. It's, you know, especially if you want to get every beat, you miss one. And I guess that's the thing. You just let it go. But sometimes I find it hard to let go of mistakes in the past. Be present, be in the moment, you know.
You talked about you know, giving us this wide range of Pete, and then we're going to take and shape it from the time we recorded, which was a long time ago now, it feels like, to now these episodes. Were you nervous about what you might see in its final form?
No, because I started watching the show and felt very comfortable watching it, you know. And then Pete's not in the beginning, and then when he did turn up, I was like, oh, that's pretty good. Oh, and then I think the biggest one that Pete has is episode 4, I was delighted. I thought, oh gosh, that's really turned out quite really well. And I honestly, I just thought, I want to know more about Pete. I just, what's the story? There's so many stories going, there's so many mysteries going on. There's so many questions. It's a bit like Lost.
It is a bit like Lost.
Will we get an answer though? Will we be happy with the answer?
Yeah, well, we're just going to tell you that it
definitely
can,
yes.
It's got a great ending. Yeah, the book.
Okay.
Yeah,
you haven't got an ending. You're not just making it up as you go along.
No. Exactly. Yes, that's so funny.
Yeah, we have a spine we're running on, that's for sure. But it's interesting because I think animation is kind of quite backwards from theater. Theater, it's immediate, it happens, right? And live action film is somewhere here, television, you know. And then animation is so backwards from the origination to its final form happens right at the end. It's like a little easy bake oven where right at the end, it all comes together and you go, what do we have? And for the rest of that period, you're hoping you're going to get something. But it's all these pieces have to come together, you know, to arrive at, there we are. So
what was it? So that's what it was like for you.
We get to experience it much like you do, where we're like, we think it's going to work. We think it's going to be good. We think, but we don't know until it's there. Like Andrew and I just walked out of this week, the final mix for the final episode of season one. And we get to see it and go, oh, that's what we're making. Fantastic. You know, we see it all its pieces along the way and you evaluate all your things, but you don't know.
Yeah. I think it's different for me because I just get to see the final thing. I think this is what I've given you. Go and I get to see it. I go, oh, that's pretty good. Yeah, I like it. Yeah, happy. So
it's a relief. Yeah. I can imagine that there would be times in an actor's
life. It's a relief.
Yes. At times in an actor's life where they go see the thing that they were in, they're like, ooh, this isn't what I was hoping that it would be, you know?
And that happens a lot. That happens a lot.
What drew you to Wingfeather and to Pete in particular? Like, what were the things that you were most excited about when you heard about the project and started into it? What were you excited to play there?
Okay, I'll be honest. You know, the first thing, I guess, was that somebody offered me an animation, which I've been trying to get into for a long time, you know? Hmm. And then when you told me the story about, you know, when Andrew told me the story about Desmond and Lost and all that, I was like, oh, okay. And then I saw the character, I saw the drawing about, oh my God, that's me. And I was like, Annie, look at this. Annie, my wife. And I said, look at this. It's just, that's you. Yeah, but you look older. And you got the thingies. So all of that, you know, I didn't know it, you know, but but as I watch it, you know, I'm super interested and excited to see where this is all going to lead to. Even though I have the books, I can see for an audience, they're going to be super excited to get the answers.
Thank you.
So Pete is a character who, you know, is comical and light and then becomes a little more heroic. And then we just saw last week in episode 5, he's extremely heroic, right? And is in quite fierce, actually, kind of a new side. I know we talked about earlier coming out of the booth, just how intense that session was when you're doing a fighting sequence that you have to make all those sounds, right? And the reveal of what was under those socks. And Andrew's talked about this. I don't know if you know this, but that I think wrote the character with socks on hands and wondered what's going to be inside there later.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, and that's kind of how writing a book works. It's like you sit down and you pretend like you're 10 years old and you go, I'm just going to tell a story. And a lot of the stuff, like, you know, the main bad guy, Nag the Nameless, I thought, that's a funny bad guy name. And then had to do the work of figuring out, okay, if I'm going to really tell this story well, why is he named Nag the Nameless? Is there a reason? It's got to be more than a joke, you know?
Yeah.
And so with the socks, I was like, oh, I had this picture in my head of this crazy town, this zany character in town with socks on his hands. And then as you're building the world, you kind of start to fill in the gaps and go, oh, that's why. Oh, I see. So it's like you're an archaeologist almost, you know, you're excavating and digging around to figure out what's going on here. Yeah. Which I was going to say too, one of the fun things about, we were talking about, does it have an ending? Having, you know, you're doing a lot of making it up as you go and you're writing a story, a long story, and just hoping that the ending works, you know, and you get to edit and try to tie everything together. But getting to make the show, we have this document, this 4-book document, where we know more at the beginning now than I did when I was writing the first book. And so we're able to like pull stuff from the end of the story into the beginning of the book in a way that really works. So it's really fun.
Yeah, that's when you have source material, when you're filming source material, it's always
Yeah.
That's the benefit, I guess. Did you really write with socks in your hands though?
Yeah. The first draft was just all just letters. Yeah, just
terrible. Exactly right. Yeah. We are gonna see in the next episode, and I, without spoiling, what are you maybe most excited about in the season finale and kind of what we're headed to? Anything in particular that stands out to you without spoiling anything?
Well, will the kids find out who Espen is? I mean, they know any more about Espen? Will they know where they come from? The dragon song. I'd love to know more about Pete. Because they kind of, I felt at the end of episode 5, there was a steeliness about Jenna, right? When they left, they were leaving, and I don't know if he's gonna, what's gonna happen with him, because when the camera was, it was a close up on him, and he said stout heart, and there was a look that he gave, was like, what's going on with him? What's happening in his head, you know? Mm-hmm. So, yeah, he's so many things.
Yeah.
Talk to us about, you know, one of the things that families have really responded to is this kind of little family unit, right? And this Pete guy that's also their friend. But one of the things that's distinct about the story is a family kind of staying together to kind of face, you know, their trials and difficulties. Tell us about, is this something that you've seen in your own family? What's your kind of resonance in that area?
Oh, yes. Yes, I think family as a family unit, you know, no one cares about you more than your family members, no matter what you guys are going through. You know, they're the ones you're going to turn to in any situation, no matter, you know, what. That's who you should, or I would hope my kids would turn to me and say, Dad, this happened. I you know, whatever. Mm-hmm. So, and you know, they're not just my immediate family, but my sister, my brother, or, you know, my extended family, even Annie's family. So yeah, we're all interlinked forever.
Yeah.
Like it or not.
Yeah. Highs and lows, right? It's all of it. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. We've talked a lot about the fact that with the Wingfeather saga, one of the things that makes it distinct from a lot of other young adult fantasy is it's almost easier to write a story where the kid is an orphan, you know, where the main character is on his own, because they've all the agency is with this character. They've got to make all these decisions. But we wanted to try to portray a family where it's like, we actually work better together, you know, where it rings truer to me that the kids would actually turn to their grandpa and say, we don't know what we're doing. Can you help? You know, rather than I'm shaking the dust of this family off my feet. I'm going to strike out on my own. So that's been an important part of the story. How many kids do you guys have?
Three. I got three boys.
Okay. Nice. Me too. I've got three. Yeah.
Three boys.
Three boys. I just had my first grandbaby this week.
No way. What? How? No, that's how old are your kids?
They're 24, 23, and 20. So the oldest and his wife just had their first. Yeah.
That's pretty young. Mine are 29, 24, and 21. So. Okay.
That's great,
but I don't think I'm not expecting any grandkids soon. I don't.
You never know.
You never know. I know.
Yeah.
You know what I love about all the kids in this show? They're all so very different, but yet so you know what Tink's gonna do. You know.
Yeah.
You know, he's so just charges in. You know, Jenna's so different. So.
Classic.
And I'm interested as right. And I'm interested in, I want, you know, the relationship, you asked what I was interested in, the relationship between Grandpa and Pete, obviously.
Oh, that's, yeah. There's something going on there. Yeah, in episode 4, when it's in the book, Poto takes him behind a wall and punches him out. And so in this one, we have him just shove him down real hard.
Right.
He just did heroic things. What's happening? And that story is going to be fun to unpack.
Because Pete is such a he seems like a formidable. He doesn't strike back. He just, you know, takes it. You know, he doesn't. He's not fighting Grandpa. And then also, Mia, you know, the mum, you know, she's very soft with him, affectionate when she does see him.
I want to talk about Andrew and I got to watch this with a group of families and kids. But in episode 4, we have a really important moment that you just poured yourself into, which is they push in, the kids do somewhat unintentionally a little too far towards someone who has trauma, and Pete kind of goes unhinged, right? And if you remember in the script, it called for, he goes so far and you just hear his screaming outside of his house.
Yeah, you did good with that.
I know you were super, we talked about this in the booth, but that was something you were like, okay, I want to find a way to do this well. Walk us through that in the booth, just kind of, you know, how do you commit to such a thing? Do you have references you're going for? Like, because it came off so beautiful and authentic and heartbreaking.
Yeah, I remember that moment. And actually, I was very pleased with how that turned out. The camera was far away and you just heard the scream, the wail from inside the house. And it didn't sound, I believed it. You know, mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I believed it. You could do anything and it would be fine, I suppose. But there was something that I believed, there was pain there. There was something like, you've gone too far with this. That memory is just too much. And you've put me in a state where it's just too much. And so I just wanted to get that, some sort of authenticity, some truth behind it. And it doesn't have, you don't have to know what it is, but as long as it just rings true. And that's mm-hmm. what I was aiming for.
That scene is so beautifully played because you it's comedic, it's charming, it's warm, and then it tilts. And you just took it so gently. And I could not be happier with where that turned out. Because on paper, it's like a daunting, honestly. And I was like, man, I hope Ian can get here because it's gonna, you got to bring the audience with you. And they've got to feel pity. Because there's versions of that could be comedic on accident, right? Where it's like, I don't believe that. It feels too broad. And great moment.
Well, you know what you gave you, I because of your very precise direction, I trusted you quite quickly, and I thought they know what they're doing, they know what they want, and with a mixture of like they're going, I see what they're going for, they're going for truth and not for just out and out comedy or, you know, gobbledygook. So I tapped into that and I tried to be as honest as I could with everything, and there were times I did think, is this suitable for animation? Am I playing it too real? I don't know. but so I was very happy. So when I saw it, that I thought you took whatever the takes you thought were right and melded it into so that it had all those different sides to it. You know,
that's one of my favorite moments in the show too. Every episode has a moment like that where you're watching an animated show and all of a sudden the bottom drops out and it gets really deep really fast. And it signals that this is a bigger story than you thought it was when you started, you know. When the camera's backing up and you hear the scream, it's such a believable scream, like you said. I just, the questions it raises in the heads of it. Like, getting to sit in a room full of children watching this, it's just a total you know.
Right.
Because we've been screening it for families and people have been coming and watching. And these kids are sitting on the front row just all in on this stuff. But those moments, like, I don't know, I'm sure you have movies that you saw when you were a kid that made you go, "Ooh, I want to do this," you know. But when I think about the movies that I love, it's those moments that I remember the most. It's not just the campy funny stuff. It's like, it's where it taps into something deep and painful and or beautiful or true, you know. So that's one of those great moments. You killed it.
Oh, well, okay, thank you. I
appreciate it. Have you encountered any Wing Feather Saga fans yet? I know they're coming for you, but, you know, have you come across
in person? No, I live in Hawaii, and I don't really go out.
Just telling you.
Yeah, I don't really go out very much, except on the soccer field and a little bit of Muay Thai. So no, but I have come across them on Instagram. I've seen some of their drawings, and I've been quite amazed at how artistic they are. So I've responded there.
So Kevin. Some Comic-Con stuff, you know, where he goes and makes an appearance, and he's got one coming up, and he's already had people approach him with books and say, "Hey, I'm a Wing Feather fan, can you sign my book?" You know,
yes, I misspoke. I have had people come up and say, "Will you sign my book?" This is before it came out.
Even before it came out,
I said, "I know you're doing this, will you sign my book?" And I was like,
oh that's so cool.
Cool. But I haven't done any conventions since it's come out, so we'll see. I think there's one in Germany though in May that I'm gonna do.
Are the books in German, Andrew? I think
I don't know if they're in German yet.
We've got I'll get these translated in all these fun languages. They're in Russian now, right?
Yeah, they're in Russian, Bulgarian, and Czech, and Portuguese. Wow. Yeah, it's all over. It's just crazy.
Fantastic.
I'm just assuming the translator is doing a good job. I don't know if they're translating stuff right.
One of the things that the fans have talked about, Ian, is that, of course, they expect that all of you acting in the show have hung out together. And, of course,
I've never met anyone.
You haven't met. Yeah.
Well, I've met Kevin because I sat next to him at one of those conventions.
Oh, yeah.
This was years ago. And so a friend of mine, Bob Morley, who I did the 100 with, said, "Do you know Kevin? Because he's a great guy." And I just went and introduced myself. We chatted very briefly. He was very nice, but he said he was a lovely man. But I've never met him. So.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, we hopefully one day we'll get you guys all together. It's a remarkable what a feeling of family and connection that you guys have created, each of you, in this journey so far. I think that the audience is in for quite a surprise as we head to the finale. Just more revealed about you and about your character Pete, which we can't wait for.
I'm excited to see it. I can't wait to see it.
Yeah. So a week from
it's
now.
A great last episode, I will tell you. We just sat in the mix studio watching the most current version, and I got big tears in my eyes. It's fantastic. Okay. So yeah, you have a lot of pretty cool moments. Yeah, you'll be surprised at how athletic you really are.
Yeah, I know. If only I could do half of that stuff in real life, you know.
Yeah, that's right.
And then coming up, I know we have coming up very soon, we're gonna get to be together for season two. And we get to expand on Pete's story even further. I know the fans are dying to understand why his hands are that way and why he behaves this way. We're going to get more of that in season two. So we'll get to be in the booth together very soon.
Great. I look forward to it.
Man, it is good to see you, and thank you.
So nice to see you. Yeah. Congratulations with it all, and looking forward to watching the next episode.
Thank you. It's a real honor to have you. Thanks again.
All right. Thank you.
Cheers.
Aloha.
All right. There's Ian, as his friends call him. Do you remember when we first talked to him at AP? I was like, "Henry Ian Cusick, nice to see you." And he's like, "My friends call me Ian."
Yeah, he is a good dude. Like, I'm so impressed with his, like, before we started the recording, he was asking about my music, and it turns out he's a drummer, which I think is pretty cool. And plays in a cover band in Hawaii, which is just delightful to know. Man, what a just classy dude, and also a total pro. Like, every time he was in the studio recording, he was all in 100%.
Yeah, and we're excited to have him back in season two. Season two is well underway, and he's got more that he's going to grow into. So, Andrew, episode 5 showed us a part of Pete and a bunch of other characters that was new. I don't know about you, but the reveal of Pete leaping into action, the black carriage, that whole black carriage scene as they're getting escorted out, just landed in ways that I was hopeful for. Like, it's the kind of thing you read in the script and you just, I hope we can get there. And then, dude.
Yeah, man, I had that same experience when we were in the writer's room way at the beginning of this process, just thinking, I can't believe I'm going to get to see some of the stuff that is in this script. I can't believe it. And then the team pulled it off. They did it great. But yeah, that moment where he first reveals his claws is just spot on. It's so great. And it's funny too, I was thinking about this, about how the people who saw episode 1, you know, I was just dying to see, like, what are the comments going to be? And people were like, we wanted more of Pete the Sock Man. And I'm kind of like, just wait, you know, it's coming. He's a huge part of the thing. It's like, he's just not going to be in episode 1. But man, yeah, I just think Ian did such a good job of that balance between really kind of zany and goofy. And man, when he says in episode 5, get out of here, he tells the kids, get out of here, and his voice cracks, you feel like, ooh, this is the real deal.
And I also love in episode 5, because I think my anticipation has been all season of like, man, if we can just unleash Poto, that guy can do some work. And he's pretty effective, but then he gets beaten down and it does take something else, right? And I love how in the story, it's not just one character who's able to overcome all odds. Like, there's need of help, right? And so Hodo ends up doing some great work then with even Nia's help, right? As she leaps into action, right. Nia, yeah. Which I, if you haven't watched this, y'all go back and watch in episode 5, just watch Nia. Like, yeah, she's so great. Cool moments in this episode.
I remember we saw Nia slam the Fang's head in the door and, he says thanks twice. I forget what both of her things are right now, but yeah. Jamie kind of fist bumped, you know, from the couch. She was like, still mom. Yeah. It's pretty great.
We've talked about this, Andrew, but obviously the kids are on a long journey. And I know in this episode, we had to kind of figure out the balance of kind of how tough they could be and how capable, right? So they can't just go grabbing swords and really, you know, shooting arrows with confidence. They're still kids. And this is their first kind of taste of this kind of action. I feel like it held a balance, and hopefully the folks at home felt, but I know for you, this is an important note, right? That they don't get too, they don't grow past where they are in the story.
Yeah, for sure. There's got to be room to grow for everybody. But like you said, I think the fact that Poto gets taken down by a couple of Fangs, well, he does at the end of episode 4. Yeah. And then he does it again here. Like, he's big and he's amazing and he's tough. He's a good fighter. But this, like, in the real world, people aren't superheroes, you know? Mm-hmm. And we wanted this to feel real. Like, yeah, these characters are in real danger. The kid, like, when Tink grabs the crossbow, he doesn't really know what he's doing. And it kind of shoots wild. And it's so much more satisfying that way than if he was suddenly just mysteriously amazing. You know, he's not Robin Hood.
Yeah. We also got to see, the consequences of fighting. And so this is the first episode that we put a little caution for parents that, like, there's going to be fighting that is deadly. And Janner gets in on that action. And then the resulting is the Fangs turn to dust. Tell me about, like, what that meaning is for you about them.
Well, I can't really get into it because of the spoiler factor, but it is a little bit of a clue to the nature of the Fangs. You know, there's something unnatural about the Fangs, and mm-hmm. I think one of those unnatural things is that they're kind of like half alive in a sense. And so, yeah, it was funny. Like when I was writing the story, that just kind of happened. It just was how it happened, and it turned out to be a good thing to have. Yeah, like I didn't know when I was writing the books that there would be an animated series one day. But it's perfect for a show like this, you know, because it's like it isn't gory. It's like no, these crumble to dust.
There was a comment. Do you remember this, Andrew? It was when we were pitching, I think, to Amazon back in the day, that they were like, okay, is there fighting with swords? Yes. Is there blood? Oh, actually, no, it'll be gray. It'll be ash. Like, that was actually something in our back pocket. Like, you know, this is actually clever. And they were like, oh, that's good. You know, ready. So weird. We also saw Brave Nugget. Nugget in the episode goes and attacks a Fang and actually helps them overcome one of them that's going to come catch them, whatever. And but then Nugget is harmed. This is a little different than it was in the books. People read the book obviously know this moment, but the result's the same. And Pete comes over, and Lily kind of trusts him. Talk about that moment, because it's a really delicate moment for her.
Yeah, you know, you got to be careful because we are, Jamie and I are funny. We're dog people without a dog. We're big time dog people. We have had dogs over the years and to varying degrees of success, but we had this one dog named Moondog that was a Great Pyrenees, big beast of a dog, wonderful dog. He was kind of like the camp dog. He kind of just trotted around the property and everybody loved him. And so that was part of the inspiration, was that that there was this dog that was just a big part of our family. The death of a pet is a big deal. It's a painful thing. And he's really Lily's dog. You know, he's not just the family dog. He's Lily's dog. And so, there's something really sweet about, you know, the same thing in Lily that makes her want to take care of Nugget, that makes her like this protector, that she has a connection with these animals, is the same part of her heart that goes out to Pete, you know, where she says, yes, sometimes he makes me sad. You know, there's something, she's tuned into Pete almost as if he were a stray dog, you know. He's a lost creature, and her heart goes out to him. So that is the source of the trust that she has. When he looks at her and he takes the dog, it's like she knows that he's going to understand, and he's going to take good care of the dog.
Yeah, it's a beautiful moment. More to come in episode 6.
Boy, is he going to take care of that dog.
All right. We want to answer a couple of your questions. We had a couple questions pop in. So let's hit this one. Let's start here. Retro 629 says, I've read the books and love them, but I have a question. Are there any noble ridge runners out there?
Great question. No. I should say not yet. None of them show up in the story. And that's kind of like the conceit of the ridge runners, is that they just are, their only allegiance is to fruit, which is basically a selfish allegiance. The ridge runners and the thwaps both came from my great disdain for the squirrels that eat all my vegetables and destroy everything I try to grow. And so, yeah, there's just this kind of selfishness. They don't care about anything around them. And so it's an interesting idea. Okay. So this is weird, but in the books, the Dragonlance Chronicles, so super nerdy, I've actually got them here. This might be worth it.
You actually have them there.
Yeah, these are the books that I got when I was a kid. Here we go. Tales, Volume 1. This book right here. I love that this is happening. I wasn't planning on this. This is called The Magic of Kryn, the Dragonlance Chronicles. And it's I'd never really heard of these before, but they just looked really cool. They've got great drawings in them. And when I was in eighth grade, this was my Christmas present. I got a set of three, and I just loved them. Anyway, in this world, it's kind of a Dungeons and Dragons-y kind of world, you know, just all the typical tropes, not super well written. But there's this creature, his name is Tasselhoff. Tasselhoff, which always makes me think of David Hasselhoff. But he's a kinder, K-I-N-D-E-R, in this world, and they're like ridge runners, smallish people. But the kinders, the thing about them is that they don't know fear. So it makes this really interesting character who, in every situation, he does not have fear. But over the course of the stories, he develops fear once he learns how to love. Because he's afraid for the people that he cares about. So it's this interesting play on this, oh, there's a whole race of creatures, but there's this one that's different. And as soon as I saw that question, I was like, oh yeah, it would be really interesting to write a story about a ridge runner that actually had a conscience.
Yeah.
But I'm not
a noble ridge runner.
Yeah. There you go.
That's great. Okay. Another question. C. Jabs asks, who is driving the black carriage?
Oh, interesting. That is a mystery that never really gets solved in the books.
No. Yeah, it's weird.
Mm-hmm.
There are some that have said because book two, the overseer drives a carriage, that they're like, oh, it's the overseer. No.
The overseer. Yeah. It's just a guy.
But I think it's interesting to your point. It is a guy. It is a human. I remember early going, oh, it's not just a fang on that thing. It's a person who's working for the fangs.
Yeah, and that was very much on purpose. I wanted to show that there were people in the world who were not wholesome. Yeah. There were people who were going to be willing to fight for the other team. Mm-hmm. And that's about as far as that got.
Yep. Okay. It's a question that's got to be asked. So we're going to stay away from the spoiler, but this name is going to be a tough one, but Lavinia Seahorn, I think, asks, is Pete half fang?
Oh.
Claws and like.
Man, the best I could say is that question is answered in the books.
That's right.
And will eventually be answered in the animated series. But if you really want to know, you got to read.
I've read the books, yeah. But it's a good question, right?
It's a very good question.
What's going on with him, right?
Yeah, and the family, the family never really has a chance to say what's up with the claws. Because you know the everything's happening. He runs away with Nugget, and they don't get a chance to ask him. But that does happen in later, probably in season 2. Yeah, in season 2 you'll find out. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
All right. Ashley Walters, this isn't really a question as much as we can just say it right out, but we love Wingfeather. Will there be a CD released with all the music from the series? Yes. I don't know if we'll actually make a CD. That's the shiny thing, Andrew, that has sound on it.
Yeah, never heard of it.
No. But we are going to release the soundtrack, and we hopefully have some more news on that soon. We love the music too. This is one of those things, Andrew, we've talked about this, but you know, because we're, like we just said a minute ago, we just mixed episode 6 and final visual effects are being added, and it is a week out from its release. That because the production is so close to that, some of these things, like a soundtrack, you have to finish writing the music.
And man, can I just say, Kurt and Isaac knocked it out of the park with the music in episode 6. You guys are going to hear it. The whole last scene is just gorgeous, and it would not be a complete soundtrack if that wasn't on there. So yeah, it's coming, but we got to finish first.
Yeah, that's true.
I just got a low battery warning, just so you know.
So we're going to hurry up. Okay. So I have to tell you, one of the big changes we talked about that we made and was really excited to do was kind of break up and have the kids have an opportunity to see Zuzab as a betrayer. Right. And to have a face to face, like, oh my gosh, Zuzab, can't believe he did this to us. Right. And then later discover what his treachery was even further. Right. Not only did he turn him over, but he also did something terrible to Oscar. So it was one of those, like, you know, I talked about this, but taking really important beats in here and finding ways to stretch them out a little bit. So revealing Esben Wingfeather as their dad, you know, well, what does that mean? No idea. Watch episode 6. You know, but that moment of Tink looking up at Zuzab, who's a guy he's been playing with, and just, I think for a lot of us, when when we're betrayed for the first time, right, and that feeling of like, ow, I trusted you, it was deeply affecting for me watching it. You know.
Yeah, the look on Tink's face when he says Zuzab, and he's kind of standing there with his jaw hanging open. It's like he didn't have room in his brain for that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then I have to cheer on, like you were saying, for episode 6, but episode 5, that last bit of music. So happy with that. And just the sadness of pulling away from home for the last time, and the kind of haunting what we're going to head into. So episode 6 picks up right there. So you do not want to miss it. Coming up next Friday, again, starting at 4:30, because we're going to do a watch party, and then episode 6 will be around 7 o'clock central. But 4:30 central, we're going to start episodes 1 through 5 together. Our whole team going to cheer it on, and we'll be all in the comments. So we're going to be chatting with you all. It'll be fun, kind of co-viewing that way. So look forward to it. Andrew, for episode 6, at the end, we have a special guest. Would you like to tell them who our special guest is for next week?
The special guest is the Little Mermaid, also known as Jodie Benson, also known as Nia Igaby, is going to be joining us, and she is awesome, and I can't wait to talk to her.
Can't wait. Yeah, we're so excited to have her as part of our finale. Don't want to miss any of that stuff. I have a couple more things to tell you about, folks, and then we have an exclusive clip for episode 6 that you want to stay around and check out. New things showing up in the Angel Studios experience in the apps. So if you are in the Angel Studios app, we now have a new thing that allows you to record a story. So if you love an episode and you want to tell us all about it, you can pop in there and say record story and record a little like a video clip memo of like what you thought. So we'd love to hear from you. If you had a reaction and want to tell us about it, that's the way you can do it. So check it out. Open the app, the Angel Studios app, and you'll click over and you'll see the stories tab, and you can pop one in there. And yeah, it's kind of fun. So I'm curious to see what people say, Andrew. You know, you can show us your costumes. You can show us your thags you've completed, whatever you think is you want to react to. Yeah,
be fun. Yeah.
And if we get some of those stories, we might be able to feature them during the finale watch party. So that'd be cool. A couple things. First, people are asking, like, you know, you love the show, you want to support us. Obviously, one of the easiest ways to support us is with a pay it forward. It's kind of like a tip jar. The show is free. If you like what you're seeing, support us, right? Help us make more of this awesome series. You can also go check out our store. We've got cool things like this cool glass, which is blurry in my camera. That amazing glass. Everybody calls them the Burger King glasses, Andrew.
Yes.
That's like,
that's so funny.
No, not Burger King, but yeah, that's the idea. Everybody puts that back in their brain. Yeah. Those are on the store as well as other stuff. Every time you go buy I'm actually wearing merch today, Andrew. Every time you go buy one of these sweatshirts, that kind of thing, you're helping support the show. And that means a ton. The other way you can support us is by becoming an owner in our company, in the show. You can invest with us, which is a pretty cool vehicle. It's what got us to this point, AP. Mm-hmm. People that said, I believe in this series and want it to go forward, and our owners. And we this week had a little Zoom meeting with some of our investors. And they're just all into it, knowing that, hey, we have contributed in very large ways, and have become owners and percentages of our company, and are helping us make all of it. So not just season one, not just season two, but the whole thing. They are with us, right? Mm. It's like buying stock in Tesla, right? You're getting all the vehicles. You're not just buying stock in the Model 3 or something. So that's out there. Invest.angel.com/wingfeather. You can learn more. Yeah, we're so thankful for your partnership, and we'd love to have a lot more of you joining. So if you've thought about it and are on the fence, now's your chance. Go check it out, learn more. I think at the beginning, Andrew, we talked about, wouldn't it be cool if we had 15, even 20,000 people that were a part of owning this show? And we've gone over 10,000 already, but we'd love to see how many more people we can bring in. And so I think that's the more interesting, right? It's like more people with smaller amounts. It's not like, you know, because eventually this is going to turn into folks where people with large amounts of money just kind of come in and who are professionals and will make this company go. And that's exciting. But you, just everyday fans, can be a part of it right now. And so I would just say too, tell your friends, tell folks about the show, tell them about what's possible with supporting us. We're community supported, have been all the way through, and we want to keep that going. So, yeah.
That it will.
All right. Season two is coming. We have already done breakdowns for season two. Like, animatics are coming fast. And once episode six finishes next week, I think there's going to be a strong desire for season two.
I was going to say, I was actually supposed to this afternoon be recording my Oscar and Retief lines for season two. But guess what? We had a massive power outage in Nashville. So didn't happen. But yeah, we're cranking along.
Yeah. And it's some of the scale, Andrew, of kind of the spectacle of season two, like what happens is like bonkers. I was just going through some layout. I don't want to spoil too much about a certain creature called a rock roach. And dude.
Oh, I cannot wait to see that thing.
Yeah, it's pretty great.
Yeah.
Anyways, it's been a joy getting season one up on its legs, and all of it's going to be streamable starting next Friday, and we can't wait. I know some of your friends have probably said, Andrew, I've had friends tell me, I'll wait till the whole thing's out. I'm more of a watch it all together.
I get that.
Do it.
Yeah. I would say too, one other thing I just remembered is that yesterday was the release of Creaturepedia and Wingfeather Tales in the UK. So the UK publisher released those books. So if you are watching this and you are in the UK, you can go pick up more Wingfeather fun at the bookstore.
Just so Creaturepedia is brilliant, and Wingfeather Tales, I love. Like, it expands the world so much. That's cool. I didn't know that. All right. So tell your friends. Tune in next week. Big finale. This is the time. Reach over people that you're like, yeah, Wingfeather, we'll see if they'll check in. This is the time to do it. And we so appreciate you telling everybody about it. And of course, they're going to get to see Jodie Benson on that. It's going to be awesome. And like we said, we have a clip to show you. So we'll say goodnight here and check out this exclusive clip from episode six coming up next week. See you then.
Thanks, everybody.
Without that blasted wagon, we'll never reach the Black River crossing before daylight.
What's our plan?
Stay ahead of the Fangs, lad.
But where are we going?
Dougtown.
We're moving to Dugtown?
Just a stop along the way, child.
The way to where?
There's a fella there can get us passage to the Ice Prairies.
The Ice Prairies? What's in the Ice Prairies besides Bob Nubbles and Snow Blizzards?
Well, hope, for starters.
Because Fang slowed down in the cold. We'd be safer up north, right?
Aye, lad. Now you're thinking like a battle captain.
Can we light a lantern? It's spooky out here.
Not in the forest. Fire draws all manner of uncouth creatures. Blats, horned hounds, toothy cows.